I want to bring on my friend who, I have to say, I've never seen anybody merch something as well as my friend Jack Carr, New York Times best-selling author. His fourth book, The Devil's Hand, which is also a weapon. And can we just look at this picture? This is a man you don't want to screw with right here. This is like, that's like the meanest look I've ever seen anybody give. And he's like one of the nicest, most gracious people that you could ever meet. And he's such a great writer too. Congrats. Your book is out. And thank you so much for this amazing. And before I even let you speak, can I show everybody what, like this?
Absolutely.
This, I almost want to go back to school so I can take this for a lunchbox. So he sends this box, right? And I'm like, oh my gosh, what is this? Is this a bomb in here? It's the nicest book box ever. So the book is, he's got his own challenge coin. Let me get, I'm like so bad with spatial reference here. The book is actually in the box and you get like this authentic leather bookmark and he's got the letter with the seal and it's always, and I love this as well, Run to the Sound of the Guns. This is one of the nicest things I've ever seen in my life. And now I feel bad that I just gave people like a picture and a flyer. I mean, this is the only thing that I think is befit of this book. Congratulations, my friend. Well deserved.
Thank you so much. And I love the intro. I hadn't heard that one part before about social media debate teacher. That is fantastic. I love it. It is perfect. I learned so much from watching how you do these things. I'm always so impressed with the way you can just take the fight to the enemy. You know, that's what we do in the military. And you do it. You do it so better than anybody else. It's incredible.
Well, thank you, my friend. And congrats, too, on your podcast as well, because you're in, is this the fifth or sixth week?
This is the fifth or sixth week. Yes. Yep. And your episode is coming up soon. I think next week or the week after. I forget how that's all laid out, but so excited to get that one out there. That was so much fun.
You've been so incredibly busy. And for people who don't know, in addition to coming out with The Devil's Hand, the fourth book here, Jack also has The Terminalist, which is the new series that's going to be on Amazon. And I'm very excited about this because I'm behind in the books. It took me a really long time, not because it wasn't good. It's just with kids and everything else, you know how it is. I actually like these types of stories. Of my favorite film genres, it's Westerns and thrillers like this, because I'm not into rom-coms or anything of that nature. I really like compelling characters, and I love just the adversity that, especially Jack Reese, that he goes through with this. And I'm really excited to read this, to check out Devil's Hand as well. And you, the thing, when we last talked, one of the things that really stuck with me, and I wanted to remind everyone else this, because Jack was on with us a couple of weeks ago, is that You were actually, when you were writing The Devil's Hand and trying to get, I mean, because you've served, you know, our country as a Navy SEAL, you're retired, we appreciate your service. You really understand this at a degree that civilians can't, and you do such a great job at presenting these stories to where they're accessible and we're right there in the action with it, which is what I really like. I like reading books in one fell swoop, so when I sit down and read, I want to make sure that I get through it as much as possible. You were researching in biowarfare. You were researching before coronavirus, before the pandemic, infectious diseases, because you were thinking that actually we're at that point right now where that could actually be employed and used against Americans or really anybody by terrorists or by, you know, enemy countries. And then the pandemic happens. That had to have freaked you out a bit.
Yeah, I was hypersensitive to it because of the months-long research I just completed in the lead-up to starting to write. And I outlined the whole thing in August of 2019. And really the basis is, what have our enemies learned by watching us on the field of battle for the last 20 years at war? So if I was Iran, China, Russia, North Korea, a super empowered individual, a terrorist organization, what would I have learned? And what would I have applied to future battle plans? Because they've been essentially watching us play poker for the last 20 years, looking at our cards, seeing how we play those cards, taking notes and applying those lessons. So that formed the foundation. And then I needed a catalyst to move the story forward. And I chose bioweapons because I needed something that, and it's not the normal bioweapon type thing. There's a little twist to it. So, and that's the most important part of the novel, but I needed something to move the story forward where it would allow Iran to use a proxy force, because between 1979 and 2001, they learned that using proxy forces worked well for them. It limited direct attacks against them, using other people to do their dirty work, that sort of thing. So that was the foundation. Then I dove in on this bioweapon research, and then COVID hits. And once again, the enemy is watching, and they are learning, and they are adapting, and they're looking at our response to COVID, and they are applying that to future battle plans. Then a summer of civil unrest hits, which continues today. They are certainly taking notes on that and applying that to future battle plans, figuring out how to use that against us. And then a very contentious political season, an election cycle hits. Once again, they are learning from that, and they're applying that to future battle plans. So as I'm writing, this became very timely. I didn't know 2020 was going to be such a pivotal year in the history of our nation and the world. But writing this story where you're looking at 2020 from the enemy's perspective, essentially what we call red selling it, that really made this book a lot more timely than I thought it was at the outset when I outlined it in August of 2019.
Wow. We're talking to my friend Jack Carr, his fourth book, The Devil's Hand. Everybody's going to really know his first as well, Terminalist with James Reese. Chris Pratt was cast as James Reese, all-star cast. I can't wait to watch that. And the weaponry and warfare obviously has changed over the years. And we were, you know, you're telling me how you were researching infectious disease. Info also is a huge a manner of fighting, info wars. And I feel like that's, we're in this information warfare period right now. And how did it strike you when, I guess it was maybe a few months into identifying the origin of like this pandemic, everybody started to get really sensitive about what it was called. China was trying to push on the World Health Organization. No, we don't want to say the Wuhan coronavirus. We need to call it COVID-19. That's how it got the name, because China was really influencing the World Health Organization on this. Now, if you even so much as try to connect the two, it's considered a faux pas. It's considered impolite, politically incorrect. And it feels like the Communist Party of China has weaponized social justice warrior culture as a way to protect itself from criticism against this and give itself some cover. What are your thoughts on that info warfare?
Yeah, so right now we can be manipulated so much more easily. There's so many different ways to manipulate the populace now than there were 20 years ago, 30 years ago, obviously 40 years ago. 40 years ago, you had to find a reporter, either blackmail that reporter into doing something and publishing stories that would advance your cause, or you had to have them on payroll and just pay them to do that. Now there are so many more ways to divide us, so many more ways to manipulate us. And plus, we have this big tech, big government L ambush, essentially, that we're walking right into, because a lot of us have businesses that are reliant on social platforms owned by those big tech companies. So we're walking right into this ambush, and there's only a few things that we can do to counter that. And in when we're talking about China, I mean, imagine being a detective in a big city in America and not following up on what people would very obviously look at as a clue. So you have a thing coming from wet markets just down the street from a lab that is experimenting with the exact infectious disease that all of a sudden pops up in this wet market. I mean, you don't need to be a detective to figure out. You should probably look into that. You probably ask a few questions about that. And the government that is typically not very upfront with its people or the world, hey, perhaps they might not be telling us the truth. So it's absolutely ridiculous. And it's insulting, actually, that big tech, big government thinks they can manipulate the populace that the way that they do. Yeah. And it's insulting to me as a citizen.
Yeah, and so, very much so. We're talking with Jack Carr, his latest book, The Devil's Hand. You served for quite a long time, obviously, in our nation's military. Times are changing awfully fast. I just saw the other day that the Navy put a face mask on the Eagle avatar on social media. And there's a lot of discussion about wokery in the military. And I understand that, you know, there social media and the use of it, I think, is odd for certain entities, especially military as well, because you want to keep people apprised. But at the same time, it's like they expect military branches through social media to go along with, you know, the cultural tides. And there's a lot of focus on the military as making it fair ground, making it inclusive, as opposed to how, I mean, it's really an exclusive fighting force. I know you've seen this, and you've seen it, you know, having a front row seat with your experience. What is your take on this? I mean, how does that, when you look back on your service and you look back at how things are now, what are your thoughts?
that I'm glad I'm watching it from the outside, very selfishly, that I'm not in the middle of it anymore. It was a good 20-year run, but I'm glad that I am out watching this from the outside, and I can incorporate. They're giving me a lot of good stuff to work with in my novels, that's for sure, just like politicians do. It's so thank them for that, I guess. But really, if decisions or issues don't move us forward as far as being prepared for war, that is the only job of the military, is to be prepared for war. And if something does not advance that cause, then it should be out of the military's purview. So be prepared for war. So when the call comes, then you go to war. That's it. So this the equitable outcomes and all the sorts of woke culture that's being that's encroaching on that that mission of being prepared for war really has no place there. It makes us weaker as a country, not just as a military, as a nation. And the military and the Supreme Court, those were the two things that really had the support of most of the American public and the respect of the American public. And now we are degrading both of those institutions as we speak.
Yeah, no, that's a great point as well. I mean, just this, we've been talking about this Marxist ideology and the theories from Marxism that are, they just, everywhere you look, whether it's in business, whether it's in education, and now in military as well. I just never thought that we would ever be having a conversation like that, and virtue signaling, watching, armed forces and their representation on social media virtue signal as though that was the important thing that they should be doing. I mean, that's happening while, we have the stories of the two warships that were going towards the Black Sea, and then they end up doing a U-turn and go away, and Daily Mail and all of these other European newspapers have it as Biden gets cold feet or Biden blinks and they make Russia look so great. I mean, it's just, it's an optics disaster what's happening with this.
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, social media, I guess they need to be there in order to recruit, because there's so many other inputs, especially for kids. That's at that true. 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20 year old time frame right there. So they're getting so many inputs from popular culture that are not necessarily the most helpful or the most patriotic. So I guess in that respect, the military needs to be there. But maybe they should focus on countering some of those, offering another option for people that are questioning some of those popular culture references and influences, to say, oh, look, here's another way to go. But you can do that with some really cool other things that show the military is preparing for war. And if that's you, if you're patriotic, you want to stand up and you want to serve, or if you want to get some skills that can lead you to wherever else you want to go in life, then here's your path. Here's an option for you, rather than the woke signaling and these politicians in uniform and all the rest of it, because that right there, that just degrades our ability to be prepared and to fight wars and our standing in the eyes of the American public.
Yeah, absolutely. We're talking to Jack Carr, his latest book, The Devil's Hand. It's his fourth book, The Terminal List. And the protagonist in that, James Reese, it's going to be a series on Amazon. Chris Pratt was he was cast in that. There are a lot of famous names that are in that series, and I know that you've been there. I've seen, and you actually just ran through a course at Terran Tactical, by the way, as well. And everyone's like, it's the same course John Wick went through. Jack Carr is John Wick. That was pretty cool.
That was awesome. And it was cold, too, because I was leaving L.A. I'd been there for 5 days. I drove out so I wouldn't have to quarantine as long before going on set, because I was there for the full week.
Wow.
And then on the way out of town, I stopped by Terran Tactical. I just wanted to say hi, drop off some books. And then they had the course set up, and I was like, all right, let's do this. But it was totally cold. So I'd never shot that rifle before, or the SIG, the Copperhead before. Obviously, I've shot Glocks before, but not that exact one. And so I just ran it. And so that was that was cold. It was knocking off the rust a little bit. And then we're just like, yeah, okay, well, let's throw it up there and see if people like it. They loved it.
Yes, I think one of the comments was like, this was his first time running this course, and this is what he did the first time running this course. Can you imagine what he would be like the fourth time he ran this course?
It was super fun. It was a great time. And but you see how Keanu runs that thing? Like, super impressed with how all the work he puts into training. And Keanu's stunt double was there. And we took some pictures together. And I was like, oh, geez, I need to get back into working out, because this guy was, oh, man, what an awesome guy.
You've been writing tomes like this. Wait, there you go.
It was, hey, there it is. But yeah, that was super fun. But being on set was incredible. So 350 people have jobs in LA. The COVID protocols are very strict, but they're getting it done. And to see Chris on set just crushing his James Reese, violent, primal, visceral, dark, gritty. That's really, I wanted to keep that from the novel. Antoine Fuqua directing, who's just incredible. Everybody was so nice. And then it was like a reunion on set, because there's about 12 SEALs that I served with, went downrange with. They're either acting in it, or they're stunt coordinators in it, or they're playing SEALs, or they're doing the technical advising. So we had this crazy reunion on set there, and people from the cast would walk up, or people from the crew would walk up and say just, hey, this is so different than any other film I've been involved with in Hollywood. And that comes from Chris and Antoine at the top, and those SEALs that are there on set just working to make this the best production it can possibly be every day.
I love that this is a series that's coming out with all the discussion of toxic masculinity and cancel culture and everything else. I love the themes that you explore in your books. I love the reading between the lines in your books as well. I love that. And I love that these stories are still being told and being made. And we got to have you back on, especially as Terminalist comes out. We've got to have you back on to talk about that as well. Make sure everybody go out, get Jack's book, The Devil's Hand. Just look for this guy on the back. The Devil's Hand. Congratulations, my friend.
My tough guy face.
That's right. Thank you so much. Appreciate you and appreciate all you do. God bless you. We'll talk again soon.
Thank you so much. And thank you for always standing strong for freedom.